Hello, everybody, and we are live. Loren Schoenberg is here, Frank Griffith is here, and we'll be back after we've heard Until Tonight. My name's Anthony Pepper. Great pleasure to have this week on the Uptown Lockdown, Loren Schoenberg. Also, of course, a great pleasure to have Frank Griffith here as usual. Frank.
Thank you, Anthony, and thank you very much, Loren, for joining us today. Loren's a very long-term friend of mine. I think we met around 1980 when we were both in our very early 20s. Loren originally comes from, I believe, is it Fairfield, New Jersey? Fairmount.
Fair Lawn.
Well, oh, so near.
Fair enough. Moved to New York to go to music college at Manhattan School of Music in the late 90s, and also teamed up with...
I moved to New York in 1976.
Oh. In the late 90s? How young are you, Lawn?
Late 70s. And at that point was working with Benny Goodman.
Yes.
Benny Goodman, who he was working as a manager and librarian, and had different facilities with the great clarinetist. And I met Loren in about 1980 through a friend called, who Loren might not remember, called Danny Schaffler, who's a pal of mine from Oregon, from whence I herald. Anyway, who cares about that? Loren had a great, and still has a great band based in New York called the Loren Schoenberg Big Band, Loren Schoenberg Jazz Orchestra, in which I had the pleasure of playing in for many years, alto and tenor different times, and also the great pleasure of having one of my arrangements recorded by Loren's band in 1992, of another great American composer called Alec Wilder's Moon and Sand. Anyway, enough about that. Lauren and I played in some really good swing bands all those years, and it was just such a pleasure knowing him and playing with him, and in many cases meeting up to play duets on two tenor saxophones and all manner of silly things that people get up to. So, Loren, of course, for those of you that had a chance to look at his website and things beforehand, has also established a lot of credibility as a writer about jazz, reviews, many liner notes, one of which won him a Grammy Award, along with the illustrious Phil Schapp of WKCR.
The first Grammy was with Dan Morgenstern.
Sorry.
And the second one was just me.
Well, I see.
Excuse me for mentioning Phil's name. He's
No. And we should talk about Phil Schapp because he's tremendously
important.
And also he's been ill last couple of years, which is no secret. He's talked about it. And and he's still teaching and still doing radio. And I wouldn't be here in a certain way if it wasn't for Phil Schapp. I can tell you about that.
Yeah. Later. Can I just mention one more thing? And that, of course, is Loren was a very longtime broadcaster on one of the great jazz stations in the USA called WKCR FM under the aegis of Columbia University. As well as he did a stint on WBGO in Newark, New Jersey, which of course is a very long time and highly regarded jazz station. And so all of these things going into the melting pot that is Loren Schoenberg. So please, Loren, welcome. And perhaps you could tell us a little bit about that beautiful track we just heard or anything you like.
Sure, of course. Well, first of all, I want to thank you and Anthony for having me. It's a pleasure to be here. And, you know, it seems kind of, I ought to be interrupting my biography there. You know, kind of I did this, I did that. But that's why I didn't want to. I just wanted to say a couple of things. A couple of additional things was that band I had became the last Benny Goodman Orchestra. And that was a big part of establishing the band's reputation. And the only other thing I'd mention was that I was lucky enough, and I know you did too, Frank, but I got to work extensively with a lot of the first generation Ellingtonians. Yes. So I did get to work with Russell Prokop and Sonny Greer and Harold Ashby and Clark Terry and Britt Woodman and Aaron Bell and probably some others too. So for me, the whole Ellington thing wasn't like something historical out of a book. It was more, you know, Frank, when you and I came to New York at that time, for me, almost 45 years ago, these guys were around.
Yeah.
And so there was a feeling about it that was very, very contemporary. The first track that we heard was called Until Tonight. And it was one of the 1941 transcription sessions that thank God they did this. You know, back in those days before, make a long story short, the record industry in the 1930s, early 30s, they thought that the record industry was going to be put out of business by radio because people would tune into the radio and they wouldn't buy records anymore. And there was a battle between the publishers of the tunes. And so what wound up happening was the record industry said, you can't play our records on the radio. So this is eventually where ASCAP and BMI started, and it was a whole big mishigas. But in 1941, Ellington recorded these transcription sessions, which were kind of like how we think now of not music, but it was music that was recorded by a band that you could play on the radio because it wasn't for their major record label. It was for a separate unit, and it was approved. So thank God of all the years in Ellington's that he could have done a transcription session. He happened to do it when Jimmy Blanton was still in the band and Billy Strayhorn had just come in and Ben Webster. So we have dozens of titles, some of which were never commercially recorded by the band. And this is a pop tune of the era called Until Tonight. And it featured Ben Webster on the tenor. And I had the great, privilege, whatever word you want to use, with John Lewis and the American Jazz Orchestra, we made a record of Ellingtonian, which I had to play all the Ben Webster solos. back in the late 80s. And it was such a responsibility. Now, if I was asked to do it now, I think I would say no.
Sure.
Or I would say, I'm not going to imitate the Ben Webster solos, but I was a good mimic. And so I had to play these things, on which you could go back and hear the original record. Now, the sum total of all this is that, and I guess it's the same for you guys, you know, there's something about the sound of Ben Webster delineating a melody like that, and it's pretty much straight, that I think would be among, you know, if I found out I had, you know, half an hour to live, you know, that might be one of the records I would want to hear.
Well, I mean, we played some of those, one of our broadcasts on WNYC radio, Loren, you compiled together a four horn pad of book of Ellington's from that period, which Ben played on. And I remember us looking at each other on that little scoop that Ben did on the fifth bar or something. He always added his own little touch as an ensemble player too, didn't he?
He did.
Scott Robinson and James, our friend James Cirillo on guitar, that I still have a tape of, believe it or not.
Exciting.
Tape. Yeah. But I just wanted
to get back to Ellington for a moment, you know, I would love to hear that tape, please. But these original players and the way that Ben, how can I describe it? It's like he's not thinking of, he's playing it like Pablo Casals. Let's just start. Okay, you know, Coleman Hawkins was a cello player. Ben was a violin player.
Sure.
And or a violinist, I think I just invented that term. And so he phrases it like that. I don't know, words like portamento and all this kind of stuff. The way he bends the intervals, and he goes, ba, and the way he resolves them. It's like a whole universe of sound. And another point about that recording, I think it's probably a Strayhorn arrangement, only because now what's interesting is Ben made some records in the early 50s with Ralph Burns arrangements with our friends Danny, and the instrumentation is very interesting because our friends Al Epstein and Danny Bank are on that record with two relatively high clarinets. I remember, like, what an odd choice, you know.
Yeah.
And then you listen to this recording, and you hear the clarinets atop some of the background, you know, and the way that, anyway, I could go on and on about that record. I just love it.
Yeah. Well, Ben's delivery of the melody, as you said, he really just sticks to the melody, and he gives such a interpretation of his own at the same time.
Yeah.
Mostly through his you know, like you said, smears and things, but also just that wonderfully resonant but kind of under control sound at the same time, you know.
A lot
less gruff than Coleman Hawkins, who clearly was a contemporary of Ben's.
Well, actually, he's a little bit older, and it was out of Ben that it was out of Coleman that Ben sprung. In fact, you know, I worked with Eddie Durham for many years, and Eddie Durham was in the Benny Moten band with Ben. And he used to tell this anecdote all the time that, you know, around 31 or 32, you know, Ben didn't start playing the saxophone until he was, you know, over 20, you know. Of course, he was taught the saxophone by Lester Young, which is a whole nother story.
Sure.
But, you know, but the interesting thing is that according to Eddie, at some point, the guys in the Benny Moten band said, okay, Ben, you're Coleman Hawkins. Great. Congratulations. Now, when are we going to hear Ben Webster?
Okay.
And throughout the 1930s, slowly, he evolves year by year, you know, through, you know, he's in Cab Calloway's band. He subs with Duke. And by the way, you know, he was a wonderful clarinetist, and there's a great jam session of him on clarinet with Jimmy Blanton and Ray Nance. And I mean, because I used to wonder, like, how did he sub for Barney Bagard when he makes those, you know, he soloed with the band in 35 and 36. He made two records, In a Jam and Truckin'. And he plays tenor solos. But I said, how could he sit in Barney Bagard's chair? Because that meant that you had to play all that clarinet. Well, lo and behold, Anthony Barnett, you know, the great scholar of jazz violin on his record label, put out this unknown jam session with Ben on the clarinet. I would love to listen to it on our next, Frank, when you and I get together, to get your take, because you also play wonderful clarinet and saxophone, and you would be able to really break it down for us.
Yeah,
I mean, he does not sound like a tenor player like me, like a tenor player who picked up a clarinet and go, doo, doo, doo. You know, he sounds like a real clarinet player. And I want to give you props because, you know, just thinking about you and all the time that we spent playing together back so long ago, you know, you were one of the few guys I knew then, you know, who was so serious about the clarinet and played the clarinet seriously, not like most sax players would just pick it up and play it. Whole notes.
Well, I had the advantage of starting on clarinet when I was about 6 years old, and
they had clarinets in Oregon.
Yeah, they had about two, and I got one of them.
Okay,
luckily, and
did they get out there by the horse and carriage or?
Well, I understand that Fairlawn High School had about three con clarinets in the band room.
Yes.
no, but Loren, this is great sharing us the beauty of Ben. And we could spend several Uptown lockdowns just using Ben as our... Mr. Anthony, do you have any idea what's next coming up?
Our springboard. I don't, actually. I've got a set of files, a set of tracks, set of music. Pick a piece.
Let's play the next one you have up, and we'll talk about it after.
Okay, it's
kind of fun to listen to it just totally blank.
Oh, I love that. Yes, absolutely. Yeah, right. So here we go. Here is Love is Like a Cigarette.
Of your fingertip, it was easy for you to forget. Oh, love is like a cigarette.
Lovely. Tell us about that one, Loren, please.
I'll tell you why I love that record. First of all, it has personal associations for me because, you know, I spent 10 years as the musical director for Bobby Short. Yeah. And Bobby loved, he knew Ivy Anderson and in a way kind of sang like Ivy Anderson. And it was through the way that Bobby met his good friend, Jean Bach, a wonderful woman who was intimate with the whole Ellington world, was because they were both friends with Ivy Anderson. And I think that when we talk about people like this, just to stop for a moment and think about, like, it's not just like they were coldly analyzing their music or some name in a discography, but these people stood for something. And especially given, you know, the horrible racism of the era in which they were living day to day to day to day, and can't stay in the hotel and you can't eat in the restaurant. But meanwhile, all these people want your autograph. I mean, it was such a complicated time. Not that it's not complicated now, yeah. But it was so complicated then that I like to approach these recordings as like almost like a snapshot of time and culture. Mm-hmm. And that Ivy Anderson, in her intelligence and in her phrasing and in her delivery, she had an ironic sense. She had a humorous sense. And I can hear all that there. Another thing I love about the record is that, you know, these wonderful, quote unquote, little Ellington piano intros and Ellington piano interludes that make modulations sometimes. Again, that's not an Ellington tune, but when Ellington arranges something like this or like the first one, which I think was a Strayhorn arrangement, it winds up sounding like an Ellington piece, yeah. Even though it's not. Also, the tremendous felicity of the arranging. I know Frank would Frank and Anthony could testify to this. You know, listen to, I don't care what band it is, Benny Goodman, Benny Carter, Cab Calloway, Tommy Dorsey, name any of the, you know, Andy Kirk, name any of the great bands of that era. And you could listen to 100 of their records and you would not find the variety of orchestration that you find in this one Ellington record. I mean, you have valve trombone on top of reeds. Yeah. You have the reed section with two or three different people playing the lead. You have in the brass section, all different kinds of configurations. Yeah. And when you look at the actual Ellington scores from that era, and you see that he wants Rex to play the lead at letter B, and he wants Cootie to play the lead at letter D, and all these kind of things. I mean, there's more variety and invention, again, in what would seeming to be, I hate to say lesser, but, you know, it's not Concerto for Cootie. It's not Clarinet Lament. It's a pop tune, and it has every single bit of the DNA of genius of Ellington it, as any of the more famous records. And so consequently, I love to go digging for these lesser known things and just kind of revel in it.
Yeah, you learn a lot about a great writer through their arrangements as well as their pieces and their own composition. And one good example of that is the, I think it was called Bring Back the Big Bands in 1961 on Reprise. And that was all big band numbers by other bands, Ellington and Strayhorn arranged, so all about 3 minutes in length, you know. But I was just thinking, in that shout chorus kind of section at the end of the last piece, you hear that really tight orchestration, and you hear the baritone, you know, sax, obviously Harry Carney, and as if he's playing the lead, and maybe not, he might not have been, but it just, the way he got the whole ensemble of horns to kind of come to him in a way, you know.
And Danny, funny you mentioned that. I'm sorry. Pardon me.
I studied with Danny Bank, and I was also, you know, in his band. You know, he was in your band for many years, and he had that quality too, especially on the Ellington numbers, some of which are on this album here. Recognize it. It's called. Yeah. Solid Ground. Anyway, I brought several CDs with me.
Well, I have to tell you, I just got a telegram from the Grammy Foundation, and they said that album just went tin.
It went in and went tin. And
not gold, but it went tin. Yeah.
Tin. Yeah. Well, tin's, you know, tin roof blues. But
I want to talk a little bit more. Yeah. Just I just want to pick up. Us. on something that you mentioned. Please. You know, sometimes I think of Harry Carney. If you want to study Ellington's music and his orchestration, like the center clue in a crossword puzzle. That, in other words, you know, one way to listen to virtually any Ellington record is to trace the baritone. And just, you can start like that. On some of the Ellington scores, on the score for Diminuendo and Crescendo in Blue, I mean, the original handwritten score, you find out that sometimes the only horn in the band who gets his own line on that sketch manuscript that Ellington used to write is the baritone.
Amazing.
And the baritone is, you know, someone that you and I knew, Johnny Carisi, used to talk about the French horn as the roving outfielder of the orchestra.
Right. That was a good quote. Yeah.
And I think that the valve trombone in Ellington's band and Harry Carney are sometimes roving outfielders, because you'll find the baritone with the reeds, you'll find him with the brass, you'll find him here and there. It's absolutely amazing.
And it really spoke, it really spoke for Ellington for that reason. And people who listen to saxophone sections or write for saxophone sections are always taught to listen for the alto lead or the tenor lead or whatever, like in Woody Herman's band. But with Ellington, the baritone might not necessarily be playing the lead, but he'll have Harry playing well up into his higher octave, and it just penetrates in a way that a tenor wouldn't. So these are things that Billy and Duke knew. They just loved so much, like you mentioned, the mutes and everything. The sound that you could get from one day to the next with the variation of the things you mentioned.
Yeah, no, it's true. You know, it's almost, I hate to say that most jazz orchestration seems naive in compared to Ellington and Strayhorn. But, you know, even the concept of thinking about lead, you know what I mean? Like lead. Oh, there's one guy, he's on top, he has the melody, you know. And, you know, when you get to, and you know this, Frank, you know, when you get to serious orchestration, there's so much more. And I'm talking to somebody who doesn't compose and arrange. You do.
Yeah.
And so I just want to make it clear to our audience here. You know, I teach these things. I've studied them, and I do know a lot about them. However, one component to my thing that I've not done really, except for three or four pieces, like Frank, you know, is actually to spend a life writing and to have someone like Johnny Dankworth and other people express great respect for your skills. My hat's off to you.
Thank you. Wow. I spent a lot of time talking to Johnny Dankworth. Or as he's known later, John Dankworth, Sir John Dankworth. A lot of what we talked about was either Gil Evans and Miles Davis in 1947, Birth of the Cool, which had that roving outfielder, by the way, in the horn. And Johnny Carisi was very much involved with that album, as you know.
Yes.
But also Ellington. John really loved all eras of Ellington, and of course interviewed Duke once on the BBC, and you know, he had a real, and he and his music carried on a lot of the Ellington Strayhorn kind of collaboration. But that was lovely. Was that last piece done in the 1930s, maybe, or?
1936?
Yeah,
and it has a nice little dollop of Rex Stewart / Bix Beider Beckian cornet on it too.
Cornet, yes.
That's all he played. He never played the trumpet.
Oh, Rex was a cornet player.
Yes.
Oh, well, there's a new Anthony. I'm sure you knew learned something new on these shows. And
well, he's usually listed as a cornetist, isn't he? And yes. So
and of course, Rex Stewart.
Just look at the pictures. Yeah.
Was a boyhood friend of the other king of jazz, Benny Carter. And Lauren and I can go on for days about Benny Carter, for the love that we shared for him and his music. But Rex Stewart was a contemporary of Benny's in Harlem as a young man. And I believe, presumably, he played cornet then as well. I didn't know that, sorry. Anyway, what else do you have, Anthony? Do you have some other music? Unless Lauren wants to say more about the last piece.
So I was just looking at this, and it was composed by two people, Jerome, but not Jerome Kern, Jerome, whoever that is, and somebody called Kent, apparently. That's what it says on the label, anyway.
It could have been Clark Kent.
I think it was the Duke of Kent.
Ah, right. So Jerome and the Duke of Kent there on Love is Like a
Cigarette. And Jerome, I think Jerome was the name of Winston Churchill's mother's family.
Oh, really?
If I'm not mistaken.
You know, gosh,
could be Harry well,
there
Jerome.
We go.
Remember Harry Jerome, Lauren? Henry Jerome.
I just remember Jerome K. Jerome. I think that's at least, what's that? I mean, you know, it's not the maximum number of Jeromes, but it's certainly getting up there, isn't it?
Henry Jerome was the creator of Leonard Garment.
So here we are, three men in a broadcast. Here we are at the moment. Yes, so, okay, so that was 1936, Ivy Anderson and the rest of the Duke Ellington Orchestra. The next piece that I have here, a little later in the 30s, I guess, assuming, yes, I hope so, is Riding on a Blue Note. So shall we hear that?
Ah, no, this is, we will preview, and we will play it. But this is a broadcast version from a fascinating broadcast of October 1945, when Sid Catlett played drums in the Ellington Band.
Oh.
And so to hear Sid Catlett parse grammatically, an Ellington arrangement, as opposed to Sonny Greer, is absolutely fascinating. So here we go. This is Riding on a Blue Note, which originally featured Cootie Williams and Johnny Hodges. Here, I think it's featuring, I think, Rex Stewart and Johnny Hodges, I believe.
Amazing.
But nonetheless, the reason I chose it was there's this wonderful hour-long broadcast and superb fidelity of Sid Catlett and the band. He also made a record date with the band for Victor at this time in October 1945. And you can hear him. He has a couple of moments, but they're two vocals and they're wonderful, but he doesn't get a chance to do much. On this hour-long broadcast, you get to hear Catlett in the band. It's absolutely fascinating.
Beautiful. Thank you.
Riding on a Blue Note there from 1935. Yeah. Frank left us and then
1945,
which means that I'm so sorry. 1945, we've moved on a decade there, yes. And so that means that they've swapped positions there because that's what Zoom does.
Oh, sorry about that. I won't do it again, promise.
Thank you so much. Well, amazing. The mid-1940s is full of amazing broadcasts, isn't it, one way and another?
Well, what happened was that there were these hour-long broadcasts called Date with the Duke. And it was pretty much like a concert, an hour-long radio concert that they did from wherever they were on the road, all over the country. And they were transcribed, and somebody saved these incredible, you know, direct line transcriptions of them. I know Mel Torme at one point issued them on LP just to get them out there. And then later on, Jerry Valburn, who was a collector's collector, issued a private set of LPs, which we all bought. You know, there were, I don't know, 50 of them, whatever.
That's right. Yes.
Of these wonderful broadcasts. But Storyville in Denmark has been issuing them all on CD. And so they're all available now. But what I love about this one is, again, is hearing Big Sid Catlett in the band. You know, he and Rex Stewart had a long history. Rex Stewart had a big band in 1933. Supposedly, it was for that band that Stomping at the Savoy was written by Edgar Sampson. But Rex and Sid, you know, had a long-term musical relationship. So it's great to hear it there. Now, on the original record, 1938, it's Johnny Hodges on the soprano. Oh, and Cootie Williams on the trumpet. Now, I recorded this with my band, with John Eckert on the trumpet and Steve Wilson on the alto sax. Actually, we recorded it many, many years ago. But hearing it here with Hodges and with Rex Stewart, absolutely fascinating. Great hookup with Junior Raglan on the bass. And it's just, you know, with a drummer like Sid Catlett or Sonny Greer, you know, there's so much more. They think orchestrationally.
Yeah.
So, you know, Ellington's famous phrase about Sonny Greer was, you know, for every orchestral ping, he has the appropriate pong, you know, a great way to put it. I think I botched it a little bit. But anyway, so that's why I played that. And that tempo, you know, I think these are tempos that you really don't hear in jazz anymore. No. I mean, when's the last time that you heard like, and they didn't turn it into 12-8 or they didn't turn it into some kind of like burning thing, you know? But here it's just kind of like floats along like this, and it kind of goes up to a low boil, and it kind of comes back down to a simmer. Yeah. It's just wonderful.
It's one of those tempos that is...
Not too slow and not too fast.
Yeah, it's unique in itself that the whole band just plays differently because it's just hit the right pocket. And of course... something we've mentioned on a number of shows, one about two or three weeks ago, which was celebrating the Fargo recording from 1940, I think it was. And that was a dance. And so the tempos were geared to dance. And just on that point, Lauren's band played for several years at this kind of rough and ready hall in Lower Manhattan called the Cat Club. And we actually played there 2 days after Benny Goodman died in 1986, and that was a very, very strong emotional gig, celebrating his life and all the rest. I just remember that stood out for me. But the point is that it was a really live place for dancing, and it was lots of really young people, some of whom were wearing the 1950s saddle shoes and all that kind of 1950s look, you know? And then the UK too. But sadly.
Well, yeah, and I just wanted to add also that, you know, the leader of the dancing frequently was Frankie Manning, this legendary figure in swing dance who was a member of Whitey's Lindy Hoppers and who had a great second chapter in his life. So, you know, he'd get out on the dance floor, and this guy who had danced to Chick Webb and Basie, he would lead the dancing, this huge thing. If you could imagine hundreds of people, almost like a scene from a movie, like doing this certain kind of authentic dancing. And, you know, I'll tell you, Frank, I'm so glad you mentioned that, because
it was a great gig.
I've always felt that you really can't understand Ellington's music without seeing people dance to it.
Yeah,
It's incomplete. And it's also incomplete to hear it only in concert setting. and it's incomplete almost to hear it only in dance setting. And it's when you can really combine those two experiences that you really get to the meat of what that music was about. It's almost like you mentioned Cat Club, you know, it's like almost like, I think, domestic pets, if you have a cat or if you have a dog, in a sense, they're schizophrenic, because a cat or a dog was never meant to live inside a house. It was meant to be out there catching mice or catching cats or catching fish, whatever the hell they do. And so consequently, you know, that a big part of an animal's thing was like catching their own food and biting the head off and all that kind of stuff. Sure. So when you bring them into the house and treat them like a child, you know, and hold them and pet them and feed them, they're kind of schizophrenic because they're half infant and half adult. Frank?
Well, speaking of great dancing, Mel Lewis, the great drummer, of course, played with Loren's band a lot. He recorded this album here. It's called Time Waits for No One.
Yeah.
Which, of course, is a song on the album, but an appropriate name for a drummer like Mel Lewis to play on. And Mel played in a lot of small groups as well. And I had pleasure playing with Mel with the great a great band called Swing Shift or something like that, led by Barry Bryson and James Cirillo on guitar, all good old friends of ours. And there was Mel Lewis playing on a cruise boat going from Long Island to Connecticut and back, you know. And he didn't drive then, so he had four pieces of drum kit he carried on his back, you know. And someone picked him up and all that. And then he would just tell us on the break, you know, Mel liked to talk about things. He said, dancers, man, you know, because he played with both, you know, Kenton's band and the other bands at that time that played dances. So he was, and the same applied for Ellington. I suppose that Ellington had to play dances. It wasn't just concerts, was it?
Well, I I'll even rephrase it. I don't think he had to play them. I think he loved playing them.
Well, had that, yes.
So he was doing his... but Loren, now, do I understand that you've prepared... You've brought some prepared piano with you?
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, Cage. Not a John Cage prepared piano.
Oh, dear.
But no...
Well, I'm so sorry, but that's all we've talked... No, sorry, please go on. Yes.
No, I've watched some of your other episodes. Frank, I hope you're going to play for us. I love the music part of it.
Oh, absolutely.
I mean it. It's a great part. So unfortunately, the way that my house is lined up here, I can't at the same time be here in my study and also tinkle on the piano.
Yeah.
So I did record myself playing an Ellington tune, and I put it kind of in a sandwich with two other songs that somehow just seem related in some way. So if you'd like, I'll share it with you.
Yeah, let's share Please that do. Out. Look forward
okay.
to it.
Okay, and just be, you know, and when you speak of this, and I know you will,
so we'll
please
still
be kind, because I'm not really a piano player.
So we'll still be on then, won't we, I think? So we'll probably
yes,
mute
we
our,
will.
So mute ourselves, yes. Okay.
Okay, go mute yourself.
Thank you.
Yeah, go.
Stay here and mute yourself.
Here we go. Ready? Here we are.
At home, and this is for... This is Loren Schoenberg at home, and this is for Frank
me?
And Anthony and all my friends at the UK branches of the Ellington Society. I'm happy to be your guest today, and I'm just going to throw together three things I've been working on, kind of a three-tier thing with three tunes that somehow seem to be kind of cut out of the same cloth. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
Frank, turn yourself
on. Hey, you're muted.
Just lovely music, Lauren. Not only the fine playing and variety of songs, but the sound quality, really a beautiful piano. Yeah. And somehow, you know, sometimes Zoom can be difficult with sound quality of instrument. I recognized the second of the three pieces, Thelonious Monk's Mood,
right,
which is one of the most, I think, romantic and beautiful Monk songs. And the first piece, of course, was an Ellington piece. But
Serenade to Sweden.
Yeah, yeah, thank you.
I didn't quite play it literally anywhere, but I alluded to it. And the third piece.
Yeah.
Which I'm so glad to turn you on to, because I'm playing it for all my friends these days. It's called High on a Windy Hill. Hmm. And Glenn Miller played it in 1941. A few people, if you look it up, you'll see Chris Connor recorded it. George Shearing made kind of like a, if Franz Liszt had written it, kind of version of it. But and beautifully played, I mean, George Shearing. But it's a beautiful tune. And I mean, just for those musician folks out there, you know, it's in C.
Okay.
The first chord is D flat major.
As you do.
The second chord is G major 7.
Wow.
And it goes all over the damn place. It's a beautiful song. And when you have a chance, listen to the Glenn Miller. There's only air checks of it, broadcast versions, arranged by Bill Finnegan.
Our favorite.
And it's one of the most beautiful records, beautiful arrangements ever written. But anyway, thank you very much. I'm glad you enjoyed it. My pleasure to do it for you.
Thank you, Ron.
Kent and Jerome. No, I'm kidding. No,
who wrote it? Around this time, yes.
Someone swapped Alec.
Sometimes one of them wrote the lyric and sometimes the other one, yes. So there we go.
I think it was Alex Kramer and Joan Whitney. Right. And if you look them up, you'll see that they don't have one song between them that's anything remotely like that. And about the piano, actually, I'm honored to say that is Benny Carter's Bosendorfer.
Yeah.
That I have at home.
Oh.
And so that's why it sounds so good. Not necessarily how I played, but because it has a good provenance.
Well, can I just say, you just mentioned two big names in our lives. Bill and Benny. Now, Loren very kindly introduced me to Bill Finnegan around 1990 or so. He did several hours of interviews with Bill on WBGO in the early 90s. And Bill brought some tracks, they accessed some tracks, one of which was the Sauter Finnegan Band radio broadcast in around 1944. Of featuring Duke Ellington, and not the band, but Duke himself. Can you imagine? And they play this arrangement that Bill did of Take the A-Train as a ballad. I just can't imagine what that was about. And Bill talked about it. I had the good fortune to study with Bill for several years. Myself and James Turillo used to go up to his house in the same car. And Bill had an incredible memory. And so thank you for sharing Bill with us, Lauren. I thought that was extremely generous of Bill. Was in his late 70s then and still had a razor sharp memory.
It meant a lot to him that you and James were so interested, because it may seem odd to our listeners out there that someone like Bill Finnegan, who's a main block of American big band jazz writing, or as original as anyone that ever was, no one really cared about him. And by that, I mean, the historians cared, the musicologists, people, the educated people about that stuff. But trust me, I think you and James were probably some of the only folks who would drive up and hang with him and show him the respect that he deserved. So I want to, just acknowledge that it was a two-way street, that it meant a lot to Bill also.
Yeah, he wouldn't take much money.
No, and he didn't suffer fools gladly.
No, and we would foist, something on him. And the way he would just tell you right off, and I think he had a lot of you know, influence in Ellington in his writing as well. But the other name that's come up and will always stay in the forefront is Benny Carter, who is, of course, almost as old as Ellington, maybe about 10 years younger or something. But he did a lot of arranging of Ellington music, one of which, I believe, Loren, you have several of these charts, he did for Sarah Vaughan, but then Sarah Vaughan didn't end up making the album for Pablo Records, and Zoot Sims stepped in in her place, so he was playing, not singing. Although Zoot was a credible vocalist, as you know, some of you might know. And I actually emailed that track to our listeners. It was Barbara Lee, who we had so much love for, and one of the great musical voices that unfortunately may have not been recognized as much as she could have. She started out in the late 50s. She made an album on a big label at the time, kind of a contemporary of Helen Merrill, I think. And then it was you, Down to You, and the late Richard Sudhalter that kept her going in the 70s and 80s. And I think, you know, we lost Barbara about 5 or 6 years ago. Does that sound about right?
Probably about 10, I think. Yeah.
Okay, sure. Anyway, she recorded this arrangement of Benny Carter's arrangement of "I Let a Song Go Out of a Heart," "Go Out of My Heart," and that was originally written for Benny, for Sarah Vaughan, I think. Anyway, just wanted to highlight that because I believe you have a solo. I don't know if you remember. This was done about 25 years ago.
No, I used to. I got these. You know, I worked with Benny a lot, and he laid those charts on me early on when I was putting my band together, very early. And he gave me copies of these things, and we played them for years in my band. I think we recorded one of them, maybe even on my first LP called "That's the Way It Goes," I think. But I used to play this as a tenor feature or something, and then she would, and then we recorded a vocal with Barbara. But Benny's writing, you know, playing with Benny Carter, it's hard to describe it. Like, you know, he would hand a chart out, and I hate to say it played itself. It didn't play itself, but it was kind of like it played itself. It was just so, it was like slipping on a jacket that had been tailored just for you. He was just incredible. And his attitude as a band leader was so diametrically opposed, like to Benny Goodman's or to other people. And I'm not even saying better or worse, just different. And
well, I remember rehearsing and performing Benny's 1939 classic of Symphony in Ritz, which had such a drive to it, you know, and what a great title, Symphony in Ritz. And he might have written it in England because, you know, Benny resided in the UK for several years, didn't he, in the late 30s. And what a gem of a chart. And of course, that music he wrote for the American Jazz Orchestra, I think, that was recorded on Music Masters, Central City Sketches. I know we're going off to Benny now, so forgive me, but I just can't forget all that he contributed. And presumably, are you aware, Loren, of any involvement he had with Duke, any kind of direct involvement?
Yeah, sure. Duke recorded an original of his called Jazz Cocktail in 1932.
Okay.
So, you know, they knew each other. Ben Webster was a disciple of Benny Carter's. In fact, there's a famous record that Benny Carter made in England in 1936 called Nightfall on the tenor sax that sounds more like Ben Webster than Ben Webster. And you can hear a lot of Benny Carter in Ben's tenor playing. And they were very, very close. And later in life in 1968, and I'm not sure that a recording exists, but Benny Carter and Johnny Hodges were featured at the Newport Jazz Festival in front of the Ellington Band. And there may be, I know there's photos. There may be a recording of it. But yeah, sure. And also in Las Vegas, Benny subbed for Harry Carney, I believe, in the Ellington Band in the 50s or 60s for a week or so.
Okay. Well, you very kindly loaned me the Edward Berger books of, he wrote two biographies of Benny Carter, Ed Berger, and his son, and I used those for my research. Thank you for that. In 1986, when I was at your old alma mater, Manhattan School of Music, which I seem to remember you reattending in the mid-80s. Do you remember that experience?
I was there from 76 to 80.
Yeah.
As a music theory major, saxophone minor, studied with Joe Allard. Then I left to work for Benny Goodman. Then I went back in 86 or so to try and get my bachelor's degree. I met you. Oh, I mean, I knew you, but you were there. John Gordon, Tony Cadleck, Andy Farber, all kinds of great players were there. And then I wound up, oddly enough, because I never got my bachelor's, I wound up teaching in the graduate department of the school I never graduated from.
They knew you. It was fine.
Which you can't do anymore. I mean, you have to have a PhD to wipe a 5-year-old's bottom.
To get over the threshold.
I'm sorry to go off pist here. PhD.
But having said that, PhDs are not necessarily what they used to be, are they? So, you know.
Well, you remember what Ed Green.
Not always, anyway.
Said, how do you pronounce PhD?
Fudd.
Elmer sorry. Fudd. That's sorry. The likable. Ed Green, who...
I think we need to hear some Ellington music here.
Yeah, I'll stop.
Oh, shall we?
Please play some Ellington.
I mean, we heard me playing the piano. We're talking about all this other stuff. But
well, that's what we do.
I need to hear Benny some Carter. Actual
that's
Duke.
And we'll get back to Benny Carter after we've heard some Duke. Yes. So what I've got next is this... is this a sort of... What is it? A private recording or something? The Strollers. Tell us about this.
Oh, yeah. This is. You know, I've chosen... lesser known recordings, I mean, tunes, the only one that, you know, we've hardly heard any Ellington pieces. We heard Love Is Like a Cigarette, we heard Until Tonight, then we heard Riding on a Blue Note, which probably a lot of jazz people know because it's the name of Gary Giddens's great book on jazz.
That's right.
But this is called The Strollers, and I believe it was written by either Blanton or Webster. I'm not sure who the composer is, but it's obviously an Ellington arrangement. It was never commercially recorded. This is a broadcast performance. I believe there's only two performances, one from 45. This is from 41 or 42. I'll look it up. And I believe Blanton is still there with Ben Webster. And it's just kind of like opening up the door to the probably thousands of pieces that Ellington wrote that were never recorded. 99% never even wound up on a radio broadcast. And this one just happened to, and it's magisterial. And it's that tempo that Frank was talking about when we were talking about Mel Lewis. But with Mel, you'd count off a tempo, not too slow, not too fast, just kind of half-assed. And you'd count off this tempo like, Now, as we all know, if you're at this tempo, 9 out of 10 bands are either going to pick it up to here or they're going to slow it down to here.
But
these are in the crack tempos, Mel used to call
it. Absolutely.
And that's one of the things about playing with Mel and playing with other great drummers, but Mel specifically, that you can just never recapture, in your heart that feeling. Because actually, the tempo is related to how your heart beats and how you breathe. Yeah. I think it's fair to say that, we've never breathed the same as we breathed when Mel was playing drums, as weird as that sounds. But anyway, let's listen to this. Yeah, let's listen to this great broadcast recording of an unknown Ellington piece.
And now, let's gather round for a hunk of rhythm under the banner of... Thank you. and gentlemen, which reminds us you still have time to stroll out here tonight. You know, this is the last night for Duke Ellington.
Last night for Duke Ellington. There we go.
That was a broadcast from, I checked it, July 42, so it would be Junior Raglan on the bass, not Jimmy Bland.
All right.
But that was Ben Webster featured, and such an imaginative arrangement. So a simple, you know, thematically speaking, a very simple, quote-unquote, simple piece with that, you know, a couple of blocks of melody repeated, but so ingeniously orchestrated. There's a modulation halfway through. Then you have the what they used to call the pep section, you know, with the two trumpets and the trombone playing yah-yah, you know, playing plunger mute stuff. Ben Webster featured, and when they go ba-da-ba-ba-boy-ba, that reminds me of the 1929 Doing the Voom Voom, a lesser-known Ellington piece with that same little phrase, ba-da-ba-ba-boy-ba, you know. And so, you know, these things resonate. And they kind of show the 360-degree relevance of everything Ellington ever recorded, how they're so self-referential. You don't need to know any of the self-references. But if you do, then they kind of, you know, they kind of pop. But fascinating recording.
Well, you get the world of Ellington in 4 minutes or whatever. I mean, you get every most aspects of it. The thing that really struck me, besides Ben just stomping along like a steam train with vibrato, was the section at the end where the clarinet is playing lead and it's kind of almost rivaling the lead trumpet, you know, for the top note in the voicing. Not as if they were competing, but you had both. And that's one of the things that Ellington did so well, and Strayhorn, of course, is they voiced the saxophone and the clarinet lead in such a way that they were in these what they call really resonant intervals, like fourths, thirds and fourths and sixths, so that there was quite a bit of distance between the voicings, you know. But at the same time, it really spoke, because there's no way a woodwind section could compete with a brass section for volume, you know. But the way he wrote for them, they clearly, you know, projected equally in a different way. But one other little anecdote, Lauren, sorry about this, but we once did a gig in Lincoln Center outdoors for dancers, and it was in the summer, in July, I think, of the year. And who should show up on tenor but the late, great Joe Temperley, you know? And I'd never heard him play tenor before. And he had the most rich, gruff, kind of almost Ben Webster-y approach. And I think a lot of that was down to his vibrato. And we've played Joe several times on this show already, because he, of course, played with Mercer's band after Ellington died. He also played, I did an album for him that he played on, you know, baritone and soprano. Anyway, and that was with strings. And it's just a beautiful sound all the time. And I wouldn't be surprised if he might have been influenced by Ben Webster, who was really a lot.
Might have been.
Yeah. No, just in the way he.
Of course he was. Of course he was.
Yeah. No, I it hit me when he played tenor, because I'd never heard him play tenor. That's why I mentioned it. But what a great musician he was. You know, one of the guys that carried the Ellington flame. Did he work with Duke himself?
Well, I'd like to talk about Joe. No, he took Harry Carney's place in the band after Ellington died. You know, I, when I was 15 or 16, I was a volunteer at a place called the New York Jazz Museum, which was on 55th Street between 6th and 7th. And when Duke was dying in the hospital and the band was off, Harold Ashby, that's where I got to know Harold Ashby. I didn't even know that he was a musician. He used to come in and hang out, because the guy that ran the museum, it was a very small little place, even about the same size as the National Jazz Museum in Harlem, but a great place. And Ashby came in, and one day Harry Carney came in with his wife, and they took a picture of Harry Carney looking at a photo, the famous photo of him in 1940 playing the baritone, and he looked about the same age. And they took this picture. And then Harry Carney died, as you know, right after Ellington.
Yeah, yeah.
And one of my treasured possessions is I wrote a condolence note to Mrs. Carney, and she wrote back, thank you so much. You know, I had this acknowledgement of a condolence card from Harry Carney's widow. But the point is that, as we talked about before, you know, Harry Carney really was like the center clue in a crossword puzzle. Once you get that clue, then all of a sudden everything else starts to line up. And so the choice of who would sit in that chair as the band continued after Duke died was, you know, probably one of the two or three most important choices that could be made. And they chose Joe Temperley, you know, who is, as everyone, probably more people listening here know more about than I do. But, you know, he was from Scotland. He came out of Humphrey Littleton's band and, you know, worked with Jimmy Rushing and came to the States in the mid 60s. And I'm very close with his widow, Laurie Temperley. We're in touch all the time. And you should invite her on or let her know about these broadcasts, because I'm sure she would love it. And I wrote a tribute to Joe, a written tribute called Three Note Joe. Okay. And the reason I called it Three Note Joe was that, like Joe Wilder, all you had to do was hear three notes played by Joe Temperley, and you knew who it was. Now, just think about that for a moment. How many players on any instrument can you hear one phrase by and go like, oh, that's Joe Temperley? You know, it's not a buzzsaw baritone or something. You know, it's you know, it's this beautiful tone. Yeah. And of course, and, you know, probably the most significant, conceivably the most significant thing Joe did, in a sense, was playing with Wynton Marsalis's orchestra for 20 some odd years, and all the music that they did and all the way that Wynton really understood and made Joe Temperley kind of the, you know, the, not the Harry Carney of that band, but the Joe Temperley of that band.
Mm. Well, he did a performance of a solo Ellington piece at a concert at the Barbican here in London, which I was attended at and probably reviewed. And it was the most gripping version of, I'm sorry, it was the...
Single Petal of a Rose?
Thank you. Sorry, I couldn't remember. That's normally played by piano solo. And anyway, he did it on baritone. He did it on bass clarinet. And gripping, gripping version. And I mean, you know, it's an old saying, but there was not a dry eye in the house, you know. So there you go. It's just, he had that majestic love for tone and melody. And he never sacrificed it for any fast, cool licks, you know. It's just a... And he was quite a personality, too. You know, he could be memorable in some of his things that he said and did.
Can I tell you something that I experienced with him? We were in Buck Clayton's band together for quite some time. And Buck wrote a feature for Chuck Wilson on the alto. Ah. And it was called Winter Night. And it was really beautiful. And we're sitting in Fat Tuesdays in this small little bandstand, like just like sitting on top of each other. And it had been driving Joe crazy because the chord changes to this tune were the chord changes from very similar to something else, but it was something that you could not recognize. And Joe kept saying, what tune, you know, what is that? You know, and I said, I don't know, you know what it is. So in the middle of this set one night, Chuck is playing Winter Night beautifully, and Joe's sitting there, and all of a sudden Joe shouts out, he turns to me, he goes, if I ruled the world. And Joe was a beloved figure. And I just want to mention, on top of everything that we've mentioned already, and I think we've covered so much of it, about what made Joe so great, he has a tremendous legacy as a teacher.
Yes, okay.
Tremendous legacy of at least two generations of baritone players. And other instruments, because boy, he played the soprano beautifully. He played all the doubles, and he was a great teacher with a list of students. I mean, a tremendous legacy. And in a sense, he was really so Scottish, and I think that that's what probably made him so great too. He was himself.
He taught every year for many years up till his passing in village of Fife in Scotland, near to Glasgow and Edinburgh, in that area, central Scotland. And he would work with the Youth Jazz Orchestra in Fife, and just remarkable commitment to continuing and sharing, and probably talking to the kids who were like generations younger than him about what it was like for him, you know, as a kid, probably working really hard in the shipyard stuff before he found music to release him from that life, you know. I'm sure his father was a laborer, you know.
I think the whole family was in the mines, I think, or something like that. Yeah.
Hey, listen, before we go, because I'd like you to play a couple more tracks, can I just give you a quick version of a song that I'd like to dedicate to Barbara, our late Barbara, because she recorded it with your band. It's Just Squeeze Me. It's on this album here that she did. Not one that you associate with a vocal, maybe, but one other aspect of Ben Webster is that he liked to pick different keys for the songs he did them. He didn't just do them in the standard key. And as an instrumentalist, you can do that, can't you? You know, because there's no singer's voice to have to kind of orient yourself to. But this is a particular song called Just Squeeze Me, and I'm going to do a Ben Webster attempt at doing it in an unusual key, which is the key of G, which is A for the saxophone tenor, as Loren would know.
Beautiful.
We couldn't see your head, but that was all right. We coped anyway.
The intro, the extra, right? But I just think that when you have a model of a player like Ben or Dexter Gordon or, you know, any of these people from that period to teach you the beauty of just trying to get the sound and the melody right, you know? That's a good start, isn't it? The sound and the melody. And then you can add the other bits in as you go, but that's quite a challenge to, you know, play those songs and just, you know, there's no need to add that much in, you know? There's such a beautiful melody there. And I'd love to hear Barbara's version of it as well, because I imagine she did it quite, you know, a tribute to the great song itself. Yeah.
Okay.
That was beautiful, Frank.
Lovely stuff. Thanks, Frank. So Lost in Meditation, Lauren.
Yeah. This is Lost in Medication.
Lost in Meditation. I've lost my medication. I think that's what it's called.
And
this is Love and Salvage.
This is later. And this is from 57, I believe. And this is the version with Ella Smith.
Yes.
And no, but it's, you know, this is the famous.
Ella Smith,
Right. the famous Ella Fitzgerald Duke Ellington sessions, and valve trombone, I guess, by the late, what a wonderful man he was, John Sanders, who I got to interview a few times. But anyway, here we go into the 50s Ellington, and just here we go.
In Meditation, Ella Fitzgerald and the Duke Ellington Orchestra, with John Sanders.
Yes, beautiful, beautiful. You know what I love about a record like that is that, you know, on the one hand, like, there's really no improvisation in that record.
No.
You know, they're playing, the arrangement is written. She's singing the melody 90%, little notes here and there. And yet it's 100% a jazz record.
Absolutely.
And, you know, that's one of the things I've always, you know, that's a hallmark for me, is that it's a paraphrase of a quote by Uncle Arnold, supposedly, but it's something along the lines of, the best composed music sounds improvised, and the best improvised music sounds composed. And, you know, it's that nexus that you get to, you know, when you hear, you know, someone interpret, just for argument's sake, a Brahms or Malcolm Arnold, I don't know, whoever, some wonderful piece written, and they interpret it with so much of an improvisatory feel, you feel like they're making it up, or a great actor, you know, doing Shakespeare. Anyway,
yes, indeed,
and vice versa, you know, that when you hear a Jimmy Rolls or a Teddy Wilson or a Brian Lemon or whomever you want to talk about, you hear them play, you know, this classic material, they're improvising.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, it sounds as though it's composed.
Hmm.
I remember when I first got turned on to Django Bates, you know, 30 years ago, by my friend Stuart Nicholson.
Yeah.
And it had this same kind of quality to it.
Yeah,
and so that's what I hear in a record like that.
So it's good, isn't it?
Sorry, Anthony.
Frank?
On Frank.
Point, a lot of Ellington songs, there's so many of them, as well as Strahan, do sound like songs that you've heard other songs, or maybe the other songs sound like them. Doesn't matter. They have similarities. And that particular Lost in Meditation has the sound of an old sort of New Orleans, what they would associate with jazz standard, called Bye Bye Blues. You know, and I know that's a little bit far-fetched, but...
No, it's the move to the flat six chord.
It has the same chord sequence, and the melody even resembles it. And of course, Bye Bye Blues is normally played very up-tempo, but it's actually such a good melody and chord sequence that it sounds good as a slow one as well, you know. And that's a mark of great music, is that it works at different tempos.
Well, it's true, you know, and you inspired me to make another connection, which I never thought of. You know, if you take something that's in the root key and you go down to the flat six chord, so that's Bye Bye Blues, and then you go back to the one chord. But if you take the flat six chord and move it up half a step and it becomes the five or the two chord, then you have, then you have I Mean You.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah, this you know, and...
He did music theory for 4 years at one of the top music colleges in the world, certainly in New York, and certainly on 120th Street and Broadway, okay?
One of the top music colleges on 120th.
Loren had a lovely flat in a very tall building. It also housed my clarinet teacher called Bill Blount, who I'm not even sure is still around anymore. What that has to do with Ellington, I know not, except to say that...
Well, I'm glad it wasn't one of the... Yeah.
What's called St. John's Church on 120th Street, Loren, do you remember?
Well, there's St. John the Divine at 112th and Riverside. There's Riverside Church Claremont Avenue and 120th. The Manhattan School of Music was on 122nd. And Bill and I actually lived on Claremont Avenue, which is in between Riverside Drive and Broadway. It's a long time ago.
Visits to your home.
One of the top music colleges on that particular intersection. Yes.
Not
the whole of 122nd Street. just that intersection.
The northwest corner.
Let me just
brilliant. Okay. Yeah.
Hold on. Just a
yes, I am holding off.
UCLA, University corner of Lexington Avenue. Okay. Glenn Miller. Remember Glenn Miller, Lauren? My friend Glenn Miller. Yes, you do.
Oh, no. Yes. Yes, I do very well. Very talented.
And anyway, I know that there was a lot of great concerts in that church, Riverside Church. The one you mentioned on Claremont Avenue.
Well, you know, it's a funny thing because, all kidding aside, Manhattan School of Music, which was the old Juilliard school, was on the northwest corner of 122nd and Broadway. Yeah. Now, one on the across 122nd on the south corner was the Union Theological Seminary.
Wow.
And across 122nd East was the Jewish Theological Seminary.
Incredible.
I'm just full of you. People say that you're full of it. I assume this is what they mean.
Yes, absolutely. New York City is certainly full of things, yes.
Well,
if not
Anthony,
it.
Why don't you ask Loren about the wonders of the Harlem?
Yes. So, well, I was just going to say, I mean, when it comes to, you know, improvised music, composed music and so on, somebody had a quote, didn't they, about if something sounds inevitable, you know, then that's a sign of, you know, greatness or something, I don't know.
Yes.
So, you know, anything could have happened, but that thing did happen, and because it did happen, that was what had to happen.
I think that was... Lord Gladstone.
Yes, it probably was. There. Yes, okay. Yes, that sounds like him, definitely. Loren, a man of many hats, literally, and one of your hats is involved with, being involved with, the Jazz Museum. Not just any Jazz Museum, the Jazz Museum, although very specifically in Harlem. The Jazz Museum in Harlem. So tell us a bit about that.
Well, God, it's like trying to describe an opera, you know, in a minute. But I should be able to, I'll try.
Is it a Wagner?
Well, I mean, it's a complicated long story, but I'll yes. make it succinct here. And thank you for asking, Anthony. I appreciate it. As I mentioned, when I was a teenager in the 70s, I was a volunteer at a place called the New York Jazz Museum. And it lasted for 5 or 6 years. A wonderful man named Jack Bradley ran it. And it was a beloved place, didn't last for a variety of reasons. Okay, so that ended. In the 1990s, I spent some time playing in a jazz repertory orchestra called the Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra. And we spent a lot of time in Washington, never lived there, but, you know, weeks at a time. And I got to know someone named Leonard Garment. Yeah. And Leonard Garment had served for various administrations in the White House. And he's really the guy who was responsible for the exponential growth of the two most significant government organizations that fund the arts, the National Endowment of the Arts and the National Endowment of the Humanities. Now, they had been founded under the Johnson administration, Lyndon Johnson, not Andrew Johnson. But after Johnson was Richard Nixon. And Len was actually part of the Nixon administration, and he was kind of the in charge of the arts.
Right.
So he's the one behind the Ellington birthday party and the exponential growth of the humanities. Fast forward. In the 90s, I'm playing in this band in Washington and New York. He would come around, and it turns out that he had a son who I'm sure Frank knew,
very well.
Whose name was Paul Garment, who was a wonderful classical clarinetist. And to make a living, played jazz and played in dance bands. But his real goal was to be in a symphony orchestra somewhere. So I got to know Len. Len decided when he got into his 70s that what he wanted to devote the rest of his life to was the creation of a national jazz museum. And so it started, it stopped, it failed, and blah, 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 blah. And it was just about to die out. And we had lunch one day in New York, and he asked me if I knew anybody who might want to take this thing on. Because they had tried and it just hadn't cottoned. And I said, I would. And he was very surprised because at that time I was in my early 40s. And I mean, this will sound, well, I don't care how it sounds. At that point, like everything in my professional career at that point had kind of all come together. I was teaching at Juilliard at the Manhattan School of Music. I was Bobby Short's musical director. I had a show on Sirius satellite radio, the Smithsonian band. I mean, everything I had reached for, it was just like everything had kind of come to fruition. And he said, you know, I doubt that you'd want to give any of that up. And I said, well, I don't think I have to give it up. He says, well, you'll see. So we started this project, and eventually I did have to dial back from almost everything as the thing grew, but I was happy to at that point in my life. And so I brought on Christian McBride, whom I already had a good friendship with and a teaching relationship with, because he had brought me on to run with him something called the Snowmass Aspen Jazz Workshop in Colorado. And so we had a good relationship. So Christian was a big role in it because he's such a great musician. And so I was like the historian type and creating the thing. And Christian was like the great jazz musician involved with it to give it some legitimacy. Yeah. And slowly, over the course of a decade or so, we opened up a small little space in Harlem, started doing programs, public programs, interviews, blah, 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 blah. And it slowly started to grow. Then I had a young kid who had come through the program in Aspen that Christian and I did, who was now at Juilliard. And he was so talented and so just so wonderful. I said, man, why don't you join us and start to do some teaching? Well, that was John Batiste. And so between John and Christian, we had these two superlative players, and I was doing the jazz history part of it and the interviews and kind of building the organization. And here we are. We are now 20 years old, as a 501c3, which means, you know, a not-for-profit.
Yeah.
We have a wonderful executive director. After about 10 years, we realized that I really wasn't the one to fulfill that administrative role. And we hired, so we have kind of a small staff of maybe half a dozen full-time. And I am now what they call the senior scholar. I also have a dunce cap, but that's another story. And that's the story. So it really became, it subsumed everything else in my life. And I'm glad it has. I still play, I still teach, I still do other things, but the museum became my 24/7 obsession.
Well,
and now specifically in this pandemic era, frankly, you know, so many of the large jazz organizations, whether it's Jazz Lincoln Center or whether it's SF Jazz, or in the UK, you have your own organizations, and around the world, there are others. You know, they're looking at furloughing or letting go most of their staff because there's no income coming in. And the Jazz Museum is a funny thing to say, because we're at such a small scale.
Right.
I think we have a great impact, because what we do is excellent in a very, very concentrated fashion. But because we're a small organization, I think it looks as though we're going to survive without any draconian layoffs or cutbacks. So thank you for asking.
Oh, that's fantastic.
For those of us that know New York, can you remind us, is it on 125th Street?
Well, it used to be on 126th. We used to be on the second floor of a dilapidated office building on 126th. But about 3 or 4 years ago, we moved to a much better location. We're on the ground floor in a new building at 58 West 129th Street.
Okay.
Right near the Times Square, so to speak, of New York, of Harlem is 125th and Lenox Avenue.
Yeah,
and we're just around the corner from there.
So you're
unfortunately, the
Apollo Theater.
Yes. And unfortunately, Frank, you and I worked in Harlem together.
Oh, with Don.
You and I worked at the legendary, the original.
I know.
Small's Paradise.
Gosh. Do you remember?
With Doc Wheeler's band.
I did several charts for him as well.
You did.
Stuff from the 1940s. And he was still alive, this old Doc, and he was smoking the whole time and everything. And Barry Bryson was in that band. You know who also was in that great band? Well, that band was the great Richard Williams, who was a trumpet player.
Richard Notes Williams.
Yeah, he played with Fat Joe's band. And a lot of great guys, and I think we even did some gigs. We actually did one gig with a singer who's since died that you might remember, called Irene Reed. She was a blues jazz singer. She sang with Count Basie.
And yes, she did, famously so.
Scots in London. But can I just mention one thing on the tail end of what you're saying about surviving institutions? The London Jazz Festival has been an annual event here in London, at least, for about 30 years. Does that sound about right, Anthony? Maybe 20 years? I think getting on to 30 years. And
sure.
They, like all gigs now, were able to do performances, but with no audiences, you know. Mm. But still, there were performances, and the people were all geared up and dressed up, and some great gigs, many of which you could see free online. So good on the LJF. And as well, the legendary club, Ronnie Scott's, which has been going almost as long as the Vanguard in New York City. Well, it's been going since 1959, at least, you know, is having gigs, and they socially distance them, you know, that bother. We've managed to stay off the topic of COVID-19 till now, but can I just say that just hope these good tidings with vaccines, whether it's the Pfizer one from America or the one in Oxford University they're developing here in the UK, that they kick in and we have something to look forward to. But thank you so much for sharing the latest about the museum.
So, the Pfizer one from Germany.
Oh, sorry.
Maybe. Well, I don't know. It's interesting, isn't it? All this international cooperation. And so, yes, the London Jazz Festival has been a fixture for quite a while, in November. And they operate their own performances in concert halls such as the Royal Festival Hall and associated halls on the South Bank and at the Barbican, as well as holding an umbrella over events that perhaps otherwise would occur, but with less publicity. And I have to say, it's fascinating to go along to concerts like that because there are so many people there that seem to only realise that they like jazz in November at the London Jazz Festival. Where are they the rest of the year?
Yeah.
But no, so they were planning on having actual gigs with audiences, few at any rate. And then, of course, the situation became significantly worse and they were not able to do that any longer.
I just wanted to mention, as long as you mentioned my Lanceman, Ronnie Scott, that there's a wonderful BBC documentary that we've got over here recently done about Ronnie Scott's. A lot of people saw. Yeah. And I also wanted to mention that just along the lines of what Anthony and Frank have talked about here, which is that, you know, for anyone watching this, you know, who take great pleasure in listening to, you know, not just us three old, you know, what's talking about the music, but who love jazz and listen to it on YouTube and listen to it on the various media things, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You know, I hate to say it, but, you know, you should feel responsible. And if you haven't donated money to help a musician or an organization, you should feel guilty because the amount of money that you spend, and I don't care how rough things are, the amount of money that you spend on any discretionary thing, whether it's a cigarette or a newspaper or a sandwich or whatever the hell it is, you know, there are musicians out there who you have created the soundtrack of your life that you've spent 30, 40 years listening to. And now, because of the way that media has gone, we think we don't have to pay for it.
Yeah.
And so consequently, you know, if you're listening to this, I say you should really consider whether it's £1 or €1 or $1, whatever the hell it is, and donate it either to a specific musician's account or to the organizations. And there are some organizations, and maybe you guys could tell us which ones you approve of, that actually do get money to musicians because you've got it for free for too long. Yeah. And this stuff is going to disappear. And you know, I hate to come on like this. I find it unfortunate that it's necessary to adopt this tone. But it is really true.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? All the times that you listen to Ben Webster and Sarah Vaughan and Duke Ellington and John Coltrane and Billie Holiday and all the live musicians out there for free, you're freeloading.
Yeah, well,
anyway,
look at all the radio stations that, that survive on funding, WKCR, WBGO. Also, for those of you, whether you're playing gigs in New York or London or wherever, in my case, Liverpool, you often have venues that don't charge a cover charge for the band, you know, to hear the music.
Mm.
People just think it's part of the, you know, the furniture. You know, it's what you get. Well, if you go to a private party, that band is not playing for free. So why should it be different at a public place? You know.
Of course.
And when I play at these few venues in Liverpool, which are hopefully starting up again, we do a strange, odd thing, but it works. And that is, instead of saying you have to pay £5 to come in or £10, like you do at a lot of gigs, like, you know, the big clubs, we just say donations accepted and put up a fancy looking, you know, receptacle. And people, believe it or not, especially in COVID times, because they're so thankful to go out and hear live music again, they will reach into their pocket. And ironically, they'll pay more than you would if you ask for a fee. You end up making more. Not a huge amount, but people are generous. But, Loren, thank you.
Yes, there's some excellent gigs that run on that basis. And don't forget also, not only the musicians, but also the dedicated jazz fans who are often not musicians, who work behind the scenes to put events on, to run gigs, often for many years or decades.
Of course,
and so
yes.
On. And you mentioned, I've forgotten his first name. I did look it up here. Leonard Garment there. So quite often it's one individual. You mentioned that, for example. in the Nixon administration. I'm sure that was one individual there in a jazz setting, and he was fortunate, I suppose, to have a tenured post there, well, a paid post there, at any rate. And so, yeah, our government's response to the problems that musicians have had since the virus has occurred in the last year or so is to suggest that, well, you know what, people should retrain. If music's no longer a thing, well, that's all right. They've got a website you can go to, and you can put in, you know, what you're good at and what you're interested in, and then it will tell you what you can become. And when I did that, I was told I should become a barrister. And I thought that was really helpful and useful advice, practical advice, I would say, from our government there. And I should just put an advert in the local paper to try to do that.
We have one here where in the States, and I put in my thing, and it said I should be the village blacksmith.
Brilliant stuff, yes. That's good news. If there were any villages, I don't know. And I'm so pleased also that you managed to get Leonard off what was presumably his first hope, which was to establish a second garment district. And instead of doing that, to actually go up into Harlem, I thought was particularly appropriate there in New York City on Manhattan Island. Yes, Frank?
Leonard used to come to all the gigs that Lauren and I did at this place called the Red Blazer, you know.
Oh, that's amazing, yes.
Kind of like the 100 Club of New York.
Super stuff. And Nixon, people...
He would come to hear his son, Paul. Paul was a good friend of mine. And he would come and hang out with the guys, old Leonard.
Yep.
He was one of the guys. He wouldn't flaunt or swagger around with his credentials. And he actually invited Henry Jerome and Alan Greenspan, who both were swing tenor players in the 1940s. Believe it or not, Alan Greenspan, who is one of the major financial figures in the States.
Sure.
And other people. It was just extraordinary.
That's amazing.
A little joint. And you know who else came one night who has only just died? It's the great, great Johnny Mandel. And Lauren interviewed him on WBGO, which I still have recordings of. And what a brilliant interview that was. So it's not always about Ellington, but
can I get a copy of that?
Yeah, I'll get you a copy. Cool.
So I don't have that.
So the Jazz Museum National Jazz Museum in Harlem. You can find details of it at its website, which is, I'm looking it up here, jazzmuseuminharlem.org.
Yeah, and it's even easier. It's www.jmih. That's for Jazz Museum in Harlem. You can just type that in. And of course, in Google, you just put in National Jazz Museum. And I'll mention on our YouTube channel, we have several dozen of our online programming that we're in the midst of doing right now.
Brilliant.
They're all up there. And you can, for instance, I have an interview airing today with Sullivan Fortner, wonderful young pianist. And then Friday, we're airing an interview that Ted Pankin and I did with a fascinating guy, George Freeman. George Freeman is a guitarist, the brother of Von Friedman and Bruce Friedman. He's 93. He played with Lester Young and Charlie Parker and Ike Day and all these people. And we interviewed him just a couple of weeks ago via Zoom. So the Jazz Museum in Harlem, plus I have a whole series I've done on Ellington. So please do join us there.
Caught some of those. Great stuff.
He's I didn't know he was that old. He's the uncle of another tenor player called Chico Freeman.
Absolutely. And Harpo Freeman.
And George was a great, he played in a lot of great organ trio groups in the 60s and 70s. And what a great player. I think he's you said he was from Chicago, didn't you? Yeah.
Chicago and totally unheralded. You know, like if he's ever been interviewed, it's been about his more famous brother, Von Freeman. But there's these live recording, live as opposed to dead, but there's these recordings at the Pershing Ballroom with Charlie Parker.
Whoa.
And with George. And George sounds like Bill Frisell's grandfather.
His grandfather, no less, yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, like he's playing like with like Jimi Hendrix or something. It's fascinating.
Oh, he just had a really rich, kind of nice, bluesy, but rich jazz guitar sound. I always remember that about his playing. And thank you for sharing that, because there's another name that until you mentioned, I hadn't thought of in 20 years. You know, so this is a great feature. And
super.
I heard one of your broadcasts about 2 months ago on a Wednesday, and Anthony heard it as well, on Facebook. We accessed it by Facebook. Incidentally, DESIC, our organization, is on Facebook. We have a page, but so is a very good page from the National Jazz Museum of Harlem.
And I'd like to mention, as long as you mentioned this, our dear friend Ray Carman, who was president of the Duke Ellington Society in New York for almost 20 years. He passed away a few months ago at the age of 85. And we have a wonderful tribute to him with David Haydu, who wrote the book on Billy Strayhorn talks, John Batiste, Christian McBride, Valerie Capers plays the piano. It's almost 2 hours long, and it's all about his love of Ellington. And you can find this tribute to Ray Carman at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem YouTube page.
Thank you.
And that really would connect our two organizations.
Brilliant.
The Duke Ellington Society and your great organization, which has, you know, so many decades of great scholarship and great sponsoring of things. I remember when I came over in 1988 to Leeds for the International Ellington Conference. I gave a paper on midriff, of all things, which, you know,
I certainly have a right to
give a talk on. And that's when I first met, you know, most of the English Ellingtonians.
Ellingtonians.
Yeah. Well, let me just say,
yes.
DESIC didn't start till 93, but still there was a lot of Ellington.
But the same people.
Oh, yeah. It was the same people. The DESIC started, I think it's true to say, DESIC started out of the conferences, including ones...
In New York in 93, we had a big one.
Oldham, probably, yes. So, okay, shall we play another piece of Ellington?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
And then we have to go,
because
Lauren's got, he's got probably a very busy lunch date scheduled.
Yes.
So here is... Without a Song. Take one. So is this the small group from
This is, you want to hear it first and then talk? Okay, great.
Yes, let's do that. Yes, sure. Thank you.
We've talked a lot. Thank you.
Beautiful.
Well, that's one of my, again, one of those desert island disc records.
Yeah.
So simple, so plain. And the reason I chose it was because, A, it's one of the first records I fell in love with of Ellington because it was on a reissue LP that I had way back when. But number two, you know, most everything else we've heard of Ellington's, it's pretty orchestrated and it's the big band. Now, this is orchestrated too, but it's a small band under Rex Stewart's leadership. Rex Stewart on the cornet, Lawrence Brown, and then Ben Webster and Harry Carney. So it's just four horns.
Yeah.
And yet it doesn't sound like it's lacking anything. There's modulations. There's wonderful piano from, I believe, I'm not sure if it's Ellington or Strayhorn on that record, but I believe the arrangement is by Strayhorn. Because I think he was doing most of the small group arranging. I could be wrong. Mm. But regardless, there's two takes of it. The only real difference is that on the opening chorus of take one, Rex Stewart is on open cornet, further away from the microphone, and kind of blending with the other instruments. On the on take two, which I think was unissued, he has a mute in and he's right up on top of the microphone.
Yeah.
And he sounds, and it blows away the balance. But, you know, Jimmy Blanton, no, it's Duke on the piano. Duke, yeah. Blanton, and Sonny Greer. And it's just so simple and wonderful. Yeah. And
well,
that's why I chose it.
A lot of great Ellington and Strayhorn in small group, and we welcome, certainly I do, hearing that as much as the big band.
So well, you know why? Because it has the compositional kernel in it. Of the fact, you know, that they're playing without a song. They are not playing C minor 7 or D 7 or G 7. They're playing a song the whole time. And this is what I think really unites Tatum and Monk and Ellington and others, is that they're never more than a stone's throw away from the melody. Tatum's always playing the melody. Monk's always playing the melody. And in these kind of recordings, the Ellingtonians are always playing the song they're playing. It's never a series of chord changes. And that's one of the things I love about it.
Well, and that one's called Without a Song. They managed to find it anyway. They are just that good.
I can just say that I think that term you just used, a compositional kernel, and I mean that in a general way because it's got a lot of major chords and, you know, a lot of private harmony.
Well, when you said major, I thought you were going to go to Colonel Clink.
No, major.
Colonel Clink.
Yes.
It had a few. Al Clink. Oh, was he related to Al Clink? Colonel Clink. Remember Al Clink?
I have a story about Al Clink, which I'll tell you in 45 seconds. Yeah, Al Clink was the other tenor player in Glenn Miller's favorite band. And amongst the band and Bill Finnegan and all the guys in the band, they really loved the way that Al Clink played. Tex Beneke was a nice singer and a very good tenor player. But Al Clink was really a creative kind of guy. And Glenn Miller would hardly ever let Al Clink play on records, and not that much in person. And he hated Glenn Miller. So I worked with him a weekend out in Long Island at trumpeter Mel Davis's club, playing the piano. And I was told by the piano player, by the guy I was subbing for, listen, Al Clink is on the gig. He's a lovely guy. Don't mention Glenn Miller. Okay. So on the gig, a clarinet player who used to play with Roy Eldridge, I won't mention his name, who we knew very well, came in, and he came in to hear the band. And I told him the same thing. Don't mention Glenn Miller. So, of course, he goes right up to Al Clink. He says, like, you know, who's first on In the Mood? Anyway,
I know that clarinet player, and I won't mention his name.
Right.
He died. Yeah. I think he died.
He has passed it. A lovely guy, but I don't want to mention his name. All right, what's the last track?
He was a lovely tenor player, too.
Yes, he was a great, great musician.
So there we go. As we wend our way back home, well, actually, we're probably already most of us at home because that's how it is at the moment. And before we prepare to spend the evening at home, I want to thank Lorne so much for being here. Much appreciated. And he's disappeared. Where's he gone? And Frank,
oh, here I am.
Thanks so much also for being here all the way live from Liverpool.
And I'm in the Bronx.
In the Bronx. Northern New York City.
Liverpool is the Bronx of England.
Frank used to live up here. Frank is one of the reasons that I moved up here.
I was Lauren's neighbor, and we used to meet up on Thursdays, do tenor sax duets. And then we'd meet at this place called the Blue Bell Cafe for brekkie. Remember that place, Lauren?
The Blue Bay. It's still there.
Brekkie, yeah, do you have the expression brekkie over in the States? Well,
that's marvelous. We have. Well, that's why we couldn't understand the big. We could never understand the huge thing in England about brekkie.
Yeah.
You know, brekkie. Why are they talking about breakfast? What's the big deal? You're in, you're out. Ireland. It was no big deal. We could never quite figure it out.
Yeah. Oh well.
But Loren shared the same building until he sadly died with one of the great musicians of jazz, Dr. Billy Taylor, who also had a lot to do with Ellington, I understand.
Oh, you know, he played. He was the one. Actually, I'm looking at a wall. I mean, I'm in my study here, and there's a wall behind me.
I hope.
And that's the wall of Billy Taylor's apartment. His wife is still there. She's 94. Whoa. And he was such a wonderful man. But you talked about his connection to Ellington. Yeah. He's the one in that great footage of Billy Strayhorn's funeral. And Ellington's in the front row weeping, and with Ray Nance on violin and Grady Tate.
Yeah.
And I forget who the bass player was. And Billy Taylor playing Take the A Train as a dirge. So that's how much he was thought of by those people.
So this
and
is
by
the
way,
the other Billy Taylor, because there were two Billy Taylors, aren't there? One of them.
Well, there's three, actually.
Oh, gosh.
There's the, right. There's the bass player
yes.
who played with Ellington. But then he had a son, Billy Taylor Jr., who played bass, who's on the famous Sarah Vaughan record Day with Miles Davis.
Oh, okay. Good.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's...
Alex, for $500, I'll take Obscure Sidemen. Oh, he passed away too.
No, well, he did, Trebek. Didn't he? Yes. But, oh dear. But, yeah, so Billy Taylor... Well, I'll take Billy Taylor's there. Yes. So, right, okay. As I say, thanks so much. What are we going to hear to finish? We're going to hear Please Forgive Me. So tell us about this, and then we'll play it and disappear.
Sure.
Okay.
This is indicative of the hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, I got to look at the number of them, but I guess several hundred Ellington recordings that exist that no one listened, I think we're all tired almost of the same Ellington masterpieces yeah. being talked about and played all the time. You know, yes, they're great and we know them and they should always be there. But, you know, Beethoven wrote a lot of other music, you know, than his 11th symphony.
He did.
You know what I mean? And so, you know, there's with Ellington, there are so many great pieces. Now, this is a pop tune that he wrote in 1938. Never played it again. I don't think anyone has ever played it. I'll look it up in the discography, but he made a record of it. It didn't go anywhere, and that was it. Is it minor Ellington? Yeah. By being minor Ellington, is it superior to 99% of the other stuff in the world?
Yes.
It's full of beautiful orchestration and singing and Cootie Williams and Lawrence Brown and playing hot potato with the trombone lead. And I love it. And I actually had it transcribed by Mark Lopeman. And we actually used to play it in my band. And I love it to death. And if it just opens up to everyone else out there, the hundreds upon hundreds upon hundreds of Ellington tunes that you don't listen to.
Indeed, yeah.
Because they're not the ones you know.
Well,
here we go.
Well, that's what's happened with... I've got a stack of LPs over there. I've actually neglected to bring one to put behind me now, but never mind. But that's one of the things that's probably regrettable about this whole digital age, that one can pick and choose. So one can hear both takes of Coco over and over again, maybe the odd concerto for Cutie. With an LP, you weren't forced, but you were sort of forced. People made mixtapes and things, but you heard a side, you know, presented to you, a whole, you know, 20 minutes or whatever of music. And so there were these deep cuts, as it were. And obviously with 78s, it was a little bit different because there were B-sides, I guess. But people had to buy each individual record. So Please Forgive Me would have been one of those on Brunswick. I have a feeling that Michael Kirkpatrick might be watching. He's often a contributor here. He leads
I'm in awe of him.
I have a feeling he might have transcribed this and played this. But I'd have to check on that. But anyway,
before we go, yes. I want to thank you.
Thank you so
much. It's nice to see you again. We have met fleetingly twice.
Fleetingly, yes.
Frank, my old friend. And also, I watched your show with Brian Priestley. I watched a whole bunch of the other ones.
Awesome.
I'm honored and very happy to be in this company. And also, just to pay tribute to, starting with Stanley Dance and so many others, the great Ellington lovers and scholars of his music who've come from the Isles of Great Britain, going back to the 1930s, and Alan Cohn, and I don't even know where to start, with all the folks who've done so much with Ellington music from Great Britain.
Indeed, well, Jack Hilton, early on, so yeah.
Absolutely. So I just want to say that it's a pleasure to be part of this. Thank you for having me.
Well,
all kidding aside.
I've been in
kind
touch
words, thank
Alan
you.
By phone recently.
He's who?
86, Alan Cohen.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, yes.
He's in London. He's 86. He's not really playing or writing much anymore, but he's still active. And I inflicted a few of my recordings, my CDs on him, you know. And I'll pass on your good wishes.
Well, you know, his analysis,
yeah.
His analysis of Black, Brown, and Beige and those yeah. things that they did back in the 70s and all that kind of stuff. I mean, it was monumental for people like me and hundreds and hundreds of other wannabe Ellingtonians.
He's still firing at all pistons.
You know? Well, I'm sure he is. I wish you were. But anyway, listen, you know.
Well, at least that's one of the four of us, isn't it? So that's good news there. So here we are, three men on a broadcast, to say nothing of the schizophrenic dog or cat or whatever it was that was referenced earlier there. And so here we are. Let's not stand on our goodbyes too much longer. As I say, thanks so much. I think 1938, is it? 1938. Please forgive me, the Duke Ellington Orchestra.